from the DSM-5, we still have to have the three main areas of struggle. So, deficits in social emotional reciprocity. All of you who train residents remember things like peekaboo, the social smile, giving and taking toys, things like that. If somebody doesn't have language, can they use nonverbal communication? Anybody who's had a toddler in their house knows when a toddler wants something, even if they don't have the vocabulary that says, go to the refrigerator and get me a slice of pizza and ice cream, they can drag you, point at the refrigerator, and demand food without enough of a vocabulary. Kids with autism can't do that. And deficits in developing, maintaining, and understanding relationships, that whole parallel versus interactive play, making friends, keeping friends, they struggle with all of that. We've talked about repetitive and stereotyped behavior. That's the twirling, the flinging, insistence on sameness. These people make OCD people look relaxed and laid back. These people are so rigid and inflexible. It's oftentimes what brings them to our attention. Fixated interest. I had one patient that liked to look at subway maps, and so every time I went on a trip somewhere, I'd grab a map and bring it back to my office, so I had it as a reward for the parents to give him when he was doing well in school. And under and over reactions to sensory stimuli, a famous one is tags in clothing and zippers on clothing. So jeans are scratchy, tags in the back of your clothing. Right now, the mic on my lapel is scratchy. So things like that bother kids with autism. It has to present early in the developmental period. This cannot magically appear at 15 when you've been completely neurotypical before that. They have to have impairment, and it can't be better explained by an intellectual disability. So somebody who's got a full-scale IQ of 40 and has commensurate behavior probably doesn't have autism, they just have intellectual disability. And same thing with a global developmental delay.